all, it's my very enjoyable job to introduce Sandi Toksvig. I'm sure that Sandi really requires no introduction to anyone. She's President of the Women of the Year, but importantly, Sandi studied law, archaeology and anthropology at Girton, and as you know, is a writer, presenter, comedian. We really decided we needed a comedian in our associates, so if we could steal you, Sandi, just from Girton, we'd be very, very happy. So a politician and a producer on radio and television. As many of you will know, she presented the News Quiz on BBC Radio 4 and 1001 Things You Should Know on Channel 4. She's written more than 20 books for adults and children, fiction and non-fiction, and she also regularly writes columns for the Sunday Telegraph, Good Housekeeping and The Lady. She's Chancellor of the University of Portsmouth. She left the News Quiz earlier this year to allow herself to set up a new political party, the Women's Equality Party. So Sandi, welcome. We're delighted to have you in Newnham, and you can start the afternoon off.
Well, I stand up here. Hello, everybody. How are you? How nice. I love the chatter in the room. I love when a whole group of women get together. There's a sort of hubbub of everybody just getting to know each other. Yesterday I addressed the Association of Women Judges, and I found myself at one point addressing the only woman on the Supreme Court as darling, and I think, why not? I think if I ever come up before the bench, I shall do quite well. I think we'll be absolutely fine. Now, thank you. Fabulous lunch. I really enjoyed it, and I was reminded when I was at Girton, there was a little tiny bit of hissing, I thought, when it was said Girton. So I had a miserable time there, so I'm delighted to be here. We celebrated the 100th anniversary of Girton while I was there, and they invited the then Queen Mother to come. And they wanted to have a foreign student to meet her, but they didn't have any, so they chose me. And I remember standing outside, and all in our gowns, waiting to meet Her Majesty. And the first thing that I enjoyed was the one of the mistresses came out and said, "If it begins to rain, you'll be informed by the vice principal." So thank you very much. Probably not going to be too good at spotting that. So thanks for that. Anyway, I was mucking about as is my wont, and I was doing what I thought was rather fine impersonation of Prince Philip when I suddenly realised that the royal party had turned up behind me. So I was doing the same thing. And I turned around, and for the only time in my whole life, absolute rubbish came out of my mouth. I literally, when she said, "Oh, good afternoon," I went, because I was so embarrassed. And do you know what the Queen Mother said? "What beautiful English you speak," and moved on. Not my finest hour. Anyway, it was good to go to a lunch where I actually managed a cogent sentence. So when I was a student at Cambridge, it never occurred to me that I'd be president of anything. Here I am, president of Women of the Year, and I have to say I've rather taken to it. As indeed Carol said, I have now started my own political party, so it's possible world domination is next. But thank you, Dame Carol, for giving us this opportunity. This is a fantastic idea, isn't it, for the 60th anniversary of Women of the Year. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with this organisation, it is an organisation I've been associated with for a very long time, and practically the mascot of the organisation. In fact, I think this year we're producing a key ring in actual size. to celebrate. It was set up in 1955 by the award-winning journalist and serial campaigner Tony Lothian. She was a force of nature, and it was to recognise and celebrate the amazing achievements of women. And Tony's vision, I think about 1955, was way ahead of her time. And what we do is we gather women from every walk of life. We have everything from shepherdesses to nuclear scientists. It is the most astonishing thing. And 60 years on, it is the only event that has that kind of spread in terms of the women that it recognises. Each woman who attends has been nominated and handpicked by our nominating council because of what she has achieved. And I was delighted to see my friend Susie Hart here. Susie won one of the awards. And in fact, Susie and I first met deep in the bush in Africa. And friendship has evolved. She won one of of our wonderful awards for her work with people with more challenging physical and mental conditions in Tanzania. She's fantastic. And Tony Luthi would have been so thrilled. She was a wonderful writer and raconteur. I remember the very first time I was asked to speak at the lunch, which is, gosh, it must be, I don't know, looking at Mary Krause, it was about 25 years ago, I suppose. Oh dear God. And Tony invited me to have lunch at the Reform Club in London. I don't know if any of you have ever been, but Tony was waiting in the foyer when I arrived. And the first thing she boomed out in a rather booming voice, she said, "Oh good, you've worn trousers, it does upset the men in the dining room." So, sadly, Tony died in 2007. What a legacy she has left, and how thrilled she'd be to know that her organisation has truly gone from strength to strength. You don't need me to tell you about Newnham, how fantastic it is, what an iconic and pioneering place it holds in women's education, attracting just the fantastically talented female undergraduates and graduates, not just from across the UK. You'd have no trouble finding a foreign student, I'm sure, to meet a royal, no trouble at all. I had the great pleasure in this room of speaking with some of the alumnae, Julie, speaking with some of the undergraduates this morning. Here's what I can tell you, rest assured the world is safe in their hands. I do feel they were fantastic. So much to celebrate between us, between Newnham and Women of the Year. So many fantastic achievements. I'm delighted that our chair, Jane Luca, invited our board to consider the ways we might celebrate our Diamond Jubilee. And it was our own Newnhamite, my new pal. We are new pals. We had jokes already on text message. So there we are, pals, right? Yeah. Because otherwise I've been, you know, sending the text to the wrong person. My new pal, Julie Etchingham, was the one who came up with the idea, and it's been embraced so that we can consider perhaps what the next decade of female achievement may hold. It's so wonderful that Alison Wolf is here to speak to us today and give us a chance to debate with our distinguished panel, Sue Owen and Eve Pollard, my friend Eve. So thank you for your generosity and for your friendship, and indeed for the new friendships which are already being forged here today, which I've thoroughly enjoyed myself. I look forward to a great afternoon's debate, and I hope it's going to be the start of a wonderful relationship that goes on into the future. Thank you very much.
Well, that was a fantastic beginning, and I'm now going to move on and just welcome Alison. I'm not going to waste too much time, because we want to give her a lot of time for her talk. But Baroness Wolf is a British economist, and she's the Sir Roy Griffiths Professor of Public Sector Management at King's College London. She's Director of the International Centre for University Policy Research at King's Policy Institute, and Director of the University's MSc Programme in Public Sector Policy and Management. Alison's recent provocative book, The XX Factor, takes a hard look at what the next decade of female achievement may hold, but crucially what obstacles remain in women's lives to prevent them achieving their full potential. I'm sure we're going to have an excellent debate afterwards, and we hope very much that there's going to be good participation from the floor. So, Alison.
Carol, thank you very much. And there's a well-known piece of advice about, you know, you should never appear with animals or children. I think you probably should also never appear after Sandi. But I'm delighted, and also it has to be said, filled with some trepidation, about talking to all of you today, because clearly this is an iconic place, and I have an audience full of immensely distinguished people. And before talking about some of what's in my book, which I hope some of you will actually feel inspired to read afterwards in order to disagree even more strongly with even more of it, I would like to say a little bit about why I wrote it and about, in a sense, how interesting it is that I ever did it. Because I never intended to write about women when I left university. I never intended to work on women. I work on the labour market, I work on higher education and training. And in a sense, the fact that for much of my career, and I think this will probably be true for many other people here, that I didn't really think that much about what it was to be a woman, about how the lives of women were changing very much, was something which defined my generation, that we were born late enough that while it was not true that we could do everything or have everything, there were a huge number of things and a huge number of barriers which would have automatically faced any previous generation of women and did not face, I think, really people in this room, that we are the lucky ones. We started on the right side of this amazing change which has taken place in human societies. And it is an amazing change because it is a change which is completely different from any other period of human history. That the fact that this room is full of people like us is something that simply could not have happened even in the early days of Newnham, when essentially you got a degree and you taught, because teaching was what you did. And so when I got talked into writing this by a friend of mine, David Goodhart, who at that time was editor of Prospect, I kept coming up against things and going, oh my goodness, you mean that was really the case in 1920/30/40/50/ and had this tremendous sensation of being on the other side. But what I want to do today is talk a little bit about how, as a result of this opening up of the world to all talent, we have not arrived in utopia. We aren't even on the shores of utopia. We are in a profoundly different place from any of our ancestors. But we also have very different challenges. And so I'm afraid I'm going to be a bit depressing and serious and talk about the things which I think the next generation of women should worry about on behalf of all women and all men. So let me start by showing a few photographs. This is the USA. This is Ireland, this is Canada, and this is Singapore. And what is noticeable about all of these? But I will tell you what is also interesting about all of these. It is that if I had shown those pictures or their equivalents outside the context of a lecture on this subject to people even 40 years ago, they wouldn't have noticed that there was anything strange about them, because that was actually just how it was. And now we suddenly see photographs pulled up from sort of cabinet meetings of the 30s or meetings between top politicians. And we go, oh, my goodness, there are no women there. But forever, nobody noticed that it was odd because it wasn't odd. And that's what I mean about this is a seismic change. And it's something where if, as does happen to one sometimes, one ends up in a meeting in which one is the only woman, at least in my world, everybody goes, oh, did you notice that? And they wouldn't have done. So this is now a vanished world. Even in Singapore, it is a vanished world. Perhaps not in Saudi, but even in Saudi, the majority of undergraduates are female. So it's a vanished world. And one of the things about it is that at the top, and I want to emphasize at the top, and by the top, I don't mean the 0.0001%, I mean us. At the top, men and women study together, and they work together, and they live together. And the other thing which I think I became aware of, and this is part of feeling how fortunate we are, is that, first of all, historically, you could be richer or poorer, but as a woman, and this is the thing that was the most defining, as a woman, your life depended on what sort of marriage you made. That was the defining fact throughout the whole of female history until very, very recently. And in that sense, there really was a sisterhood. You made a good marriage, you made a bad marriage, and that set your life, and there was no escape from it. So that is no longer true. But the other thing that I think is no longer true, and that perhaps we should also acknowledge, is that you no longer have to be truly extraordinary as a woman to have a career. Again, you know, I think we are all very aware of how utterly amazing many of the pioneer women were. But what makes me say that, although there are certain, you know, there are things that are still an issue, but what makes me say that basically this revolution is accomplished is that these days you can just be ordinarily lucky and hardworking and talented. You don't have to be extraordinary any more than you ever had to be extraordinary as a man to have a truly successful career. And I think that those two facts are, for all the issues, for all the fact that it's not true all over the world, those are two things which no generation before 1970 probably could have said those things. And now we can. So just to sort of remind people and then hopefully tell you a couple of things that you don't already know. One of the things that's quite interesting about this is that, let's leave aside FTSE 100 companies, just take what are called class one jobs in social science, which are sort of professional managerial, just the number of them. Across the OECD, half of the class one jobs are now held by women and half of them are held by men. So again, that's been true since 2000. If anything, it's slightly more women now than men. But that, again, is something which would have been extraordinary. And the other thing that I want to show you is how recent it is. And again, you know, this is something which has actually happened very, very recently. This was one of the things that actually staggered me, particularly this one. That was 1971. And now it's there, and if you look at the number of people coming through law school and so on, it's going up. So this has happened very, very, very fast. It's happened very fast, it happened dramatically, and basically the floodgates opened from the 1970s on. That was the point at which, you went beyond the pioneering generations and it became a mainstream activity. And the other thing that I want to say, before saying a little bit more about the underlying dynamics of what was going on, is that this is not just about the West. One of the things that's really interesting, which I don't want to talk about very much today, is that doing this book also made me aware of, if you like, the role of values. The fact that people in developing and emerging economies have a different set of values and beliefs from the ones that people in this country held, or that they held in America at comparable levels of income. So if you look at China today, it is full of self-made female billionaires. If you look at the United States in 1910 or 1900, not only were there no female judges, there were no self-made female manufacturers, entrepreneurs, businesswomen. Even if you look at those parts of the world which are hanging in there and, you know, battling to maintain male supremacy and female inequality and all the rest of it, the reality is that they're all educating their daughters. If you take one of the apparently most reactionary super bloggers among the Iranian clerics, he has four daughters, all of whom have got science PhDs. So this is a set of values which are different, and it's what makes it sets a completely different dynamic up. It also means that we too can do really self-made corrupt politics. Yay! So the route to the top. I wanted to say a little bit about this because here I am standing in Newnham. I'm also somebody who benefited from the classic Oxbridge degree, and yes, it opens gates, it opens doors. The whole way in which women's lives changed utterly was bound up with a wider social change, which was the growing importance of formal education. Formal education has always been important, you know, ever since we had settled agricultural societies, the rulers needed people who were literate, they needed their lawyers, they needed their palace administrators. But from the sort of period when trade increased, when we began to have real growth, real middle class, period leading up to and from the Industrial Revolution, formal education became more and more important because more and more jobs involved literacy and educate, you know, the sorts of skills which are associated not just with learning a craft through an apprenticeship, but actually with formal classroom study. And as our societies demanded more and more formal education, we also became societies which, for a variety of reasons, partly efficiency because you didn't know everybody, and partly a set of values, we also became more and more committed to demanding formal credentials. And it's become, you know, in my lifetime, less and less acceptable to give somebody a job because you knew them, or at least to admit that you'd given them a job because you knew them, as opposed to having the formal credentials. And I do think that even if there's hypocrisy in that it's a real change. When nobody can admit that that's why, it does change things. So women have benefited from this. And they've benefited from this in a number of obvious and perhaps also slightly less obvious ways. So as we know, women are the majority of university students everywhere, and that's not just in the less good universities. Some of the numbers that I collected, which I thought were fascinating, which, you know, I'm because, after all, you guys know exactly what's happened in Oxford and Cambridge, but I thought this one was really interesting because this is the top private colleges in the Northeast. It was all of them, and so I've included the Seven Sisters there. So that was Ivy League plus seven sisters in 1950 to 51, and that was the number of men and the number of women. And on the right, I've just done the Ivy League. And what doesn't come out quite so clearly as I'd like it there is that even in the Ivy League, even in the old men's colleges of the Ivy League, which only went co-ed in about the 1970s, 51% of the students are now female. So this really is a sort of a mixed ruling class of the future. But there is a downside to it. And the downside is what I'm going to say something about, though I'm also going to come back to the whole reason why it became so important that for women that this was an education-based society. Because what I've described is an international story, but it's a story in which, if you like, class starts to trump gender in the story of women's lives. Because for the 15%, the class one, what you have is a life which is increasingly like men's. But if you look at the rest of society, you find that men and women still lead very, very different lives. Now, I don't mean by that men's lives are good and women's lives are bad. There are ways in which that's true and ways in which it's not true. But what is true is that for the vast majority of people in a society, your gender predicts a far larger part of your life than is now the case at the top. And one thing that has happened, which I have to say is inevitable, really, given where we started, is that inequality among women is growing faster than among men. Now, as I said, to some degree, that's inevitable because it reflects the number of women who are succeeding compared to those who were succeeding in the 1970s. But I think it's something that we should nonetheless be aware of. You know, everybody's against inequality. Nobody likes to think they belong to the top 1%. Everybody always thinks they belong, they're far further down the income distribution than they, well, almost everybody actually thinks they're further down the income distribution than they actually are. I guess once you get to the bottom, that can't be true. But almost everybody thinks they're further down than they are. But I do think we should pause and ask whether one of the things that has happened is, as I said, this world in which to be an educated and successful woman is more and more similar to being an educated and successful man. As this has happened, as inequality has grown across society and as inequality has grown among women in the same ways and even faster, is this something which we should be seeing as a major challenge, something that actually morally, thinking of the strong moral impulses of our 19th century forebears, that as women we should be taking more seriously? So part of what is happening is that what the sociologists call assortative mating has increased everywhere. And what that means is that people marry people like themselves or mate with people like themselves even more than they used to. Now, as I said, this is bad news for milkmaids and goose girls. I don't suppose the goose girl very often really did get the prince, but she certainly doesn't these days, and nor does the glamour model. The people who become glamour models, the people who are following these, what is a very age-old route, are those who can't do it via formal education. And, you know, the reality was, I said in the past, that your marriage decided your life. I mean, actually, you had, leaving aside those people who became nuns, there was one other thing you could do if you were a woman. You could get married, or to put it bluntly, you could go on the streets. That was your fallback. And one of the things I was actually terrified and horrified to discover was that there was no welfare safety net, after all, in the past. And people who came from, perhaps I shouldn't have been shocked, but you do when you start digging into it, discover that the number of people that it was perfectly possible to fall from a middle-class lifestyle to the London gutter, not infrequently. And a lot of writing this book has made me read Jane Austen a little bit differently, but discovering that happened and that many people would know of somebody to whom it happened has made me really sympathise with Mrs. Bennet. So, assortative mating has increased everywhere. And so, obviously, not everybody marries, not everybody partners, but in fact, a large number of people don't. But I think that to see what has been happening and to see how this dramatic change in women's lives came about, it is important to think about this and to think about the point I made earlier, that as our societies have changed, we've needed more and more people who had formal education. Because if you kind of look at our lives from aggressively economic or Marxist or whatever point of view, I mean, you sort of ask yourself, why did the men let us get away with it? Why did we actually not find it that hard in the end to push on these doors? What were the men faffing around at? Was it just that they couldn't get organised? Because, you know, we are competing. And, you know, for every woman who's now in the Ivy League, that's some guy who isn't. So what were they doing? And I think one has to understand it in terms of the marriage market and in terms of what both males and females want for their children. Now, I'm not going to suddenly turn this into a lecture on chimpanzees, who aren't very nice people anyway. but one of the things that is always quite interesting is to look at the things which are constant across all living species and certainly across all primates. And the reality is that people always want good fathers for their children and good mothers for their children. In any society which is actually social, as opposed to, you know, you lay your turtle eggs and off you go and it's up to them, they take care of themselves. This is always true. And one of the things that is very interesting, if you are into primatology, I'll probably discover that one of the world experts of primatology is in the room, is going to tell me how wildly simplistic I'm being. But one of the things that is quite interesting is how sophisticated the techniques of the women and the men are in this situation, the males and the females are. And if you want to study kind of game theory, I recommend primates. So primate females want high status males to father their children, and primate males want high status females. And what has happened is that in industrial societies, men increasingly wanted women who were not just pretty and not just rich, but were actually intelligent, so that they would have intelligent children, who would the intelligent sons in the first place, who would do well in life, because you wanted your sons to have the opportunities of this new world to pass, to get into the Indian civil service, to do well. And who were themselves educated, because, again, if you look at what middle-class women did for much of the time, from the time when women started getting educated in any large numbers, was they taught their own children. So what was happening during the 18th and 19th centuries was that the self-interest of men also encouraged the education of women. And I think that that's actually something which is profoundly important, because it did mean that by the time the barriers started to fall, we already had behind us generations and generations of women who were actually educated. And I would say in modern post-industrial societies, women are following exactly the same strategies. I mean, it's sort of two careers, but again, you want a good parent, you want a good father for your child. You don't actually want a tommy boy. So what this meant was that you'd got a changing marriage market, you'd got something which fed into the increasing importance of education. And that meant you had an increasing demand for educated workers, you had an increasing demand for educated wives, you had an increasing demand for teachers. And as everybody here knows, teaching was the female profession. If you go and you look, I mean, when I was writing this book, I went to my own old college, which was Somerville, and I went back through some of the annual alumni magazines, and it was just staggering. Everybody became a teacher. If they became anything, they became a teacher. There were a few unbelievably amazing people who clearly didn't. There was somebody in the 1930s who actually ran an ironworks, but I kind of figure she probably inherited it. I haven't been able to find her anywhere. So. But basically, just everybody taught. That's what they did. So women took off from there. It meant they were educated. It meant that they were out there. But what it does is it explains why, to put it bluntly, men didn't gang up to stop women's progress, and why once you actually start having things fall, once you reach critical mass, once you have changing values, once we push hard, whatever, you have a mass of educated women there. So that's what happened. So you've now got your two groups. You've got your highly educated women and you've also got your other women. Just as for men, you've got highly educated men and you've got other men. Now, there are a number of ways in which when you start looking at data and you look at the graduates against everybody else, or the graduates of good universities versus everybody else increasingly. What you're struck by again and again is how you are moving into a world in which it's as though there were sort of two tribes, two different sets of people. Now, obviously, it's not quite that brutal. Obviously, it's actually there's loads of stuff at the margin and people move. But nonetheless, again and again, when you sort of run the numbers, you're really surprised by how highly educated adults are very different in a whole load of ways from the rest of the population. And increasingly so. And that's the really interesting thing, increasingly so. Okay, one of the things which is very interesting is the big differences in fertility. Very large numbers of men and women remain childless among the graduate population, far more than among the non-graduate population. The childlessness rate among women, UK women in their mid-40s, is twice that for those who leave school at 16, and the group in between are closer to the 60, the least educated than they are to the graduates. Again, this is an international pattern. And the important thing is it applies just as much to men, because the men are not going off and marrying people who left school at 16 and having sort of five babies by five different adoring blondes. They're not. So what you're getting is you're getting, first of all, this big, big difference in infertility rates. This is the Harvard and Radcliffe graduates, where a couple of people have been doing really detailed studies. I don't have anything comparable for the UK, or I put it up. But I thought kind of Harvard and Radcliffe is the right one to show Newnham, people at Newnham. Radcliffe was the female equivalent to Harvard that then got rolled into Harvard. And as you can see, there's not much difference between the men and the women. Slightly larger average number of children for the men, but really not significantly. These children are born with silver spoons, but there really aren't many of them. That's an average number of way below replacement. That's about 1.3 on average. Now, you know, the normal conventional replacement one is 2.1. So this is a group that is not reproducing itself. Then again, traditionally, people had children quite early. And there were no major class differences and no differences as late as the 1960s in how long people stayed at home once they'd had a child. So somebody who had left Newnham with a good degree or even a PhD and had a child would stay at home on average before going back to work for exactly as long as somebody who had left school without a single O-level or CSE to their name. Now you have this huge gap. First of all, graduate women don't stay home for very long. They all go back pretty fast. But above all, they have their children way, way later. So it's not that everybody is having children late. So when next time somebody says to you, I don't know anybody who has a child before they're 30 these days, you can remember me standing up here and saying, and that shows that just like me, you live in a fairly restricted social circle. So what you're getting, as I said, is two female tribes. You've got the group, way beautifully represented in this room, who work not just for money, though we're not starving, but for whom their work is part of their identity. And I think that's really the defining thing. Is your work really part of who you are? It's not about not liking going to work. It's not that you don't go for the company as well as the money. But is your work your identity? Is this something, is it about the sort of person you are? So that's the critical thing. They work in mixed workplaces. They have very brief or no career breaks, late childbearing, late marriage, and many are childless. Whereas on the other side, you get the bulk of the population who work for money, work above all in much more traditional female occupations, tend to break off work when their children are young, or go part-time, often stay part-time, and it's if you go part-time that your wages go down. And the reason you have the big gender gap is for a very large extent because when part-time workers don't go up the tree. Childbearing much earlier, and often childbearing without marriage. That's the other thing. The highly educated tend to get themselves married before they have their children. So again, this is something where you're getting these big, big gaps. Dramatic in America. Graduates just, white graduates, it's not quite so clear for black graduates, but white graduates in America just don't have children out of wedlock. Very interesting, completely dramatic. So the end of sisterhood. And it is an end of sisterhood. It doesn't mean that you can't feel a real tie to other people who are female, but the reality is that whereas in the past, the Rudyard Kipling poem about, you know, Colonel's Lady and Judy O'Grady as sisters under the skin, I mean, never mind sisters under the skin, their lives were determined in the same way. Who did they marry? Did they have children? Today, that is just, it's not that we have nothing in common as women, but we have far less in common as women than women in any previous part of history. So what you've got is you've got two career, two high income couples and families and single professionals, about 15% of the employed population in developed countries. And these are the people who work not in completely 50-50 workplaces, but they work in occupations which are gender integrated. And the remainder of the labour party market remains highly gendered. And that's even more true in Scandinavia because of the nature of their occupational structure. And just to show you the big occupations, secretaries and administrative assistants, 97% female. Registered nurses, 92%. This is nursing, psychiatric, home health aid. Sorry, I've got American labels on this one because I did this one for an American audience. I apologise. So I'd have put care assistants. Maids, housekeeping, cleaners, 90% female. So this, I think, is also the brutal fact, which is that professionals, at least until we have really created robots, can have the lives they have because other people are doing jobs which we no longer need to do because we have actually outsourced the things which our female ancestors worked at from day to morning till night. You cannot have a successful professional career as a man or as a woman unless you are also able to outsource a large number of your household tasks. In the past, people used to bring servants into their houses. To a large extent today, we buy services outside our houses, but we don't cook our food from scratch. We don't have careers while also looking full-time after children. We don't, on the whole, whatever people pretend, clean our own houses and iron our own shirts. And that was true in the past. Virginia Woolf needed a room of her own, but she also needed and had servants. And so do we, and we pay them out of post-tax income, and therefore they have to be brutal, earn less than we do. So I think this is a reality, and it's not about women should feel worse about it than men should feel worse about it. I mean, this is just about professionals versus non-professionals. And so these people, and the people who bring your takeaway pizza and, you know, how many people here did not eat a single meal that somebody else had got ready last week, not counting today, because obviously we've all just done it. So anybody here who actually had every single meal at home and cooked it themselves, that's amazing, there's even one, two. And how many people had, this includes, by the way, kind of, you know, I'm going to be really mean, I'm going to include a sort of a latte that was almost a lunch. How many people here had at least one meal outside the house last week which they bought or which somebody else cooked? That is a sea change. It's a real sea change. So one of the things that we have is we have the global care chain, which women in their millions move countries and are often the prime earners for people at home. I lived some of the year in Italy, and in Italy it's Moldova. The women come from Moldova and there are no jobs in Moldova. Mm-hmm. So the women come and work in Italy, particularly looking after aged parents, and they send the money home and the economy depends on it. And the problem is that caring for other people is intrinsically expensive. This is not something where you can get huge technical breakthroughs unless, as I said, we finally get those miraculous robots. So that, I think, is the world where we are today, and I hope that the panel will have something to say about it. And I think it's not something about women feeling guilty. It's, to me, the next problem, the fact that we are in these societies and that at the same time, and I was talking to Carol about this at lunch, we seem to be in economies where the well-paid middle jobs are actually declining in number. But I want to finish very quickly with something else, because it's also about how I expected this, and it was true. I expected that when I came today, I would be really struck by how great everybody looked. And actually, you do. You all look absolutely great. And I have to say, my hunch is that if we had had something like this in the past, where a lot of even Newnham graduates had become either just they taught or they'd become, you know, their mothers and housewives. People would not have looked quite so fantastic, because one of the other things which I became very aware of, and this goes back to, you know, it's not about getting your mate, but it's part of the whole thing that comes out of snap judgments, how we look, how we come over. It's the price of success. That to a not inconsiderable degree, you guys are successful because you come over as high quality, high worth, fit individuals. And it's the price of success, though I think it's not that painful a price. Basically, the other thing you become aware of, and again, this is something which I think you really see the difference between people who are doing professional careers well into their 50s and 60s, and large parts of the population, particularly other women. You know, it's sort of quite, you know, it makes you feel really bad sometimes when you meet somebody who you realise is actually, to put it bluntly, quite a lot younger than you and doesn't look it. Is that we all want to show we're fit. We all want to come over quite subconsciously as successful and highly rated, and we use the signals that other people respond to. And the longer our working lives, the more we're working competitive and well-paid jobs, and truthfully, there are always exceptions, but you know, I deal in data. The general rule is that when you look at people who are successful, they also look good. And it isn't just about money, it's about effort, and it isn't just about feeling good about yourself, therefore you go and buy it. It's also this whole sort of dynamic of, if I'm going to be successful, I need to come over as successful, I need to come over as somebody who's fit. And sometimes it can be quite costly. And anyone who doesn't know what those are should just... and it's a sign that you don't care about the cost. If you that you know, if you are wearing stuff that is extremely impractical, this is a New York thing. In New York, there is absolutely no question that if you actually wear these outside the office instead of wearing your sneakers to walk up and down the avenues, that means that you are really going everywhere by cab. But it's the same story as the peacock's tail, which again I think most people will know, the sort of the why on earth does the peacock have this completely impossible tail, because it's a way of saying to the very dowdy peahen that he is such a superior male that he can stay alive and father really good children even when he's carrying that thing behind him all the time. And this is one of the sort of the famous things. But it's the point I want to finish on a slightly more sort of unserious note, which is that one of the ways in which our lives have changed is that we are, for far longer as women, out there competing. It's not just about getting your man and settling down. It's about remaining in the competition, remaining in the workplace. And one of the things that, again, anybody who has lived in, who can think back is in, and thinks of, for example, a country like Italy or Spain, before female careers and also before divorce, we'll remember that basically from about the age of 40, women became dumpy, completely uninterested in their appearance, and dressed in black. And the contrast between, well, no, all black, you're not all in black. you look at one of these. Actually, some of the Dolce & Gabbana adverts at the moment. They've got those old. Anybody notice those? Yes. Exactly. Yes. And they really did. They looked like that. They all looked like that. When I first went to Italy as a child, they looked like that. So signalling is about a lot more than sex, and very rarely about sex in the office. And it's done by everybody, male and female. It's also, of course, potentially misleading. But I do also want to tell you a couple of other facts, which is, first of all, anybody who's rude about hairdressers hasn't noticed the world they're living in. This is an ace profession to be in these days. The demand for it is going up and up, and all the hairdressers I know say nobody in the top 15% really cut back on their hairdressers in 2008. But the other thing, which is, I think, quite interesting, quite depressing, is that good-looking men and women, this is both sexes, both just as much, tall men, and I'm afraid slim women, do get paid more on average, and there are always the exceptions, than people who are otherwise the same as them. So it is worth having your hair cut properly. It is worth not going grey. It is worth buying those shoes. And buying the shoes is kind of nice anyway. but I thought I should finish by telling you that all the facts support this position, whether or not you want to be in it. But just to finish quickly, because I know that I'm running out of time, but not only by 3 minutes. Are we in steady state, or are there more huge social changes coming? What I've tried to do in the book, and tried to do to sketch out here, is to say that one of the things that's happened as a result of female emancipation, as a result of there being all these people who are out there as successful professionals, successful business people, and who are also female, is that all sorts of things about our social structures have changed. One of the things that's changed is these new divides, but all sorts of other things have changed. Is there a lot more to come from the female revolution, or are we kind of advancing towards steady state, though, you know, we still need, you know, still not many judges up there, not many, but are we sort of over that? Listen, it's hard to know. My own sense is that this particular revolution has done most of its, whatever it is, revolutionising. That there are bits that will still continue, bits that will go a bit further. But just as 30 years ago, I don't think anybody would, for example, have predicted the huge increase, the huge levels of breakdown in nuclear families, the huge rises in children born out of marriage, would not have predicted that. They also wouldn't have predicted the implosion of what are called, what people used to call wage earner jobs, jobs in which men could support a family without being graduates. I think what the one thing one knows is that there is something coming up there that we've none of us noticed yet, which will have a huge impact. Will it have good or bad implications for educated women? I honestly don't know, but I think it will be very, very, very hard to put us back into the kitchen. So thank you very much, everyone.
Sorry, I'll try to be able to say, excuse me, thank you. Now, we are, as busy women all, time pressed, but there is so much to get into as a result. Fascinating points raised by Professor Wolf. And this idea, I suppose the leaping off point, have we reached steady state? What is coming up on the rails that we need to be aware of? Eve, what was your first observations on what you heard from Professor?
Well, first of all, let me just tell you, I enjoyed your book very much, and lots and lots of information. And actually, I believe every book about, as it were, the success of women. Oh, I'm so sorry. Only two people could hear that. Could you hear me now? I just want to say how much I enjoyed it. And every book that's written about the success of women is great because, frankly, although you say we're going up and being more successful, the men have realised that we've parked our tanks on their lawns and they don't like it one bit, certainly not in my old profession or my current profession. Secondly, I think there is an enormous change about to happen. If I could just very briefly talk to you about my family. Should I stand up? I feel I'm... Anyway, I can't because I'm attached to a thing at the back. Sorry, I am actually a robot. So I have a daughter. Some of you may know my daughter. She's called Claudia Winkleman. She works very hard. She has three children. And she did it, and she gave a very interesting interview to the Radio Times a few weeks ago, saying she did it because she saw she could, because I was out every day. I was working. She seems to have grown up. Her brother seems to have grown up healthy, wealthy, and relatively wealthy and wise. I have a daughter-in-law. Her mother worked for the public sector. Now my daughter-in-law works for the BBC. Her mother went to work. She saw how it happened. They both of these girls went to university, had children relatively early because they're now becoming more aware that freezing your eggs only works 25%, and they're also aware that there are problems if you have children later. I have a stepdaughter whose mother never worked, and she has chosen not to have children, chosen not to get married. She's beautiful, and she has chosen to have a career. And she says to me, what has my mother accomplished? And that sounds terrible. She had several children, many of whom she had and then married their fathers afterwards. Let's not go into that. This is first wives and second wives. But the interesting thing is, she is now a bit older than me, but she has done no work. Nobody asks her to come to lovely things like this. she's pretty lonely. And she never, and I think this is what my daughter-in-law saw, my stepdaughter saw, never had any power. So if you don't provide any money, even though you may be married to the most wonderful man, you just don't have that push, that say-so, etc. And my last person is a niece of mine whose mother married, never worked, married a very successful man. My niece went to a terribly good school, never worked because there was this fantastically successful man. Got married without, had a baby without getting married, and at now 43, scrabbling to catch up, but decided not to get married to people who've asked her, not to have another child. She is now wanting to join the world of work. And I think that it's not just about being alpha, going to university and education, which all of which I take on board. It's about having some power, some self-respect, some information to your own life. You can choose to go away. You can choose to do something. You can choose to do all sorts. Look at Sandi, who's done a million different things in her life, and many columns on days when I imagine she woke up and thought, oh my God, it's Good Housekeeping Day today. But that was a choice. It was a choice you made because you wanted to earn money for various things. I think what will happen is all of the women who are working today will raise children who want to work because they've seen the other side. Now, that doesn't take away anything from child raising, but it looks in this age that having a baby, staying at home, is dull, and going out to work and kicking men on the shins, I don't mean literally, is much more interesting. And as for the end of feminism, for me, feminism has always been all women, not me. So yes, of course, I do pay a cleaner, but that's going to educate two boys in the Philippines. Yes, of course, I've had dailies and nannies. I mean, I can't get rid of them. They last forever because I always felt I owed them much more than the salary I paid them. And I would like to say that my first nanny earned £15 a week less than me. My salary went up a bit faster than hers, I have to admit that. And about the careful signalling, I read your book in The Hairdresser, The Dentist, and I thought, boy, she's got that right.
Eve, thank you. And it's a good leaping off point to go to Sue, actually, because you, one of your key aims in your extraordinary position in the civil service is to help women to navigate careers and to find that path if they choose to take it. What are your observations on what you've heard? Okay. I might need to pass you the microphone.
Well, I've got one of these little things here, but maybe it's not working. Before I say anything, I just want to say something about cooking. As Alison mentioned that, and I don't want anyone to run away from here thinking that Alison doesn't cook, because I know perfectly well the division of labour in her home is 100% that Alison does the cooking, and I also know that when I have excess supply of quinces from my tree, that I know where I can take them, which is to leave a whole bag of them on Alison's doorstep. But I think the key point about cooking is that we have the choice now, and we can do it when we want to, and not because we have to. I mean, I agree with, it's hard to disagree with a lot of what Alison says, but I personally, my observation from my own career is that women are still not fulfilling their potential, whether they are educated or not. And, you know, even amongst well-educated women, are they on an equal platform? I don't think they are necessarily yet. You know, 53% of the civil service is women. If you did that pie chart, you'd have more women than men in the civil service as a whole. But in the senior jobs, it's 38%. And in the very top, the permanent secretaries, there are 8 out of 30, depending on how you define it. And the thing is, everybody knows the names of those 8. Nobody could tell you the names of the 22 men. You know, look at government and parliament. I mean, we're struggling in the cabinet to have many women. Women in sport, very little portrayal of women, sportswomen in the media, women in the media. So we don't see very much there. We've still got issues with the gender pay gap. It is the lowest it's ever been. It's 19% now. And for full-time women under 35, there is no gender pay gap at the moment. So I think there's still quite a lot of policy that we need to be doing. You know, we do need to be getting more girls into science and technology and engineering occupations, into those well-paid occupations. We do need to carry on modernising the workplace. There has been a lot of progress on things like a maternity leave and now shared parental leave. We do need a lot more transparency about pay, and we need to do more to broaden girls' aspirations. The thing I've always said from my own career is that if every woman aimed one higher than she thought she could get, you know, it's not all about getting to the top, but if everybody could get one higher, we would be getting a long way.
Thank you very much indeed, Sue. Dame Carol, your observations on that, and I know just from the conversations that we've had and I know you've had with other women today, you know, you look at the young women here at Newnham and a lot of this bears on your mind very heavily.
Yes, it does, but I want to come back, if I can, to the social class transgender, because actually what you say and what I've seen in the work I've done recently for government, so many women who sit way below the people in this room. And I think, how do we make it better for those women? And I think we haven't really given very much consideration to that. And at the lowest end of those women, you say that it's better to be in work. But there's quite a lot of good evidence now that, in fact, a psychologically poor job, when you've got poor work, poor workplaces, well, actually, it's more damaging for your mental health than actually being in our benefit system. And that's a dreadful thing to have to say. So for me, not so much about the people here or this university, I think what you've shown is truly important. And I don't know that we have got any of the answers at the moment of how do we deal with that. And so my sense is there are a lot of women, 0 hours contracts, part-time work, when we think, we know they don't go to the hairdressers more often. I wish they would take more care of their appearance, because it does affect a whole lot of things, as you said. But why don't they? There may be very good reasons for that. So that whole area that you've discussed, to me, is a very important one. Coming to our young women here, I think what's most important for me is that they leave this place going to do something they really care about. Now, that may be, you know, the city. It may be a job in teaching. But I'd like to think they go to it with some passion and a real desire to move on with that job, and not, that's what I most want them to leave with. And I think we can do quite a lot in helping them to have the right confidence and risk-taking. I think Sue was coming, talking about risk-taking. You know, you can't get a job you don't apply for. And that's been the most important thing I think I've ever said to the young women that I mentor, you know? And that means you have to learn to deal with failure. I wouldn't like to tell you how many jobs I didn't get.
That idea, though, of the end of sisterhood that Professor Wolf raised, that chime, I mean, when we're talking about these inequalities, Eve, Sue, and Carol, is there a sense of responsibility that we all bear within this, if that is true?
I think there is a worry about that, certainly. I mean, it's interesting. I come from the journalistic, creative side of life, so people like Jack Monroe, the girl who lived on her own and did a book about, she had no money. Caitlin Moran had no money. I grew up with very caring parents, but there was no money. And my father stopped me from going to university and thought that was a complete waste of time, as I was going to get married, have children, and as my mother died quite young, look after my husband and him. It's very important, I think, that education is everything. And what is interesting about Caitlin Moran or Jack Monroe or myself, we self-educated. And in a way, what would be really interesting is to say more often to girls, these are the six books you should read, because there were books I read that Jane Austen, of course, one of them, that made a difference. These are the things you should know by now. And explain why looks happen. I never forget, I did a program about Nora Ephron earlier this year, and she said, I remember walking along the street and seeing a woman walk to me with grey hair and the teeth weren't right and the skin was right. And she said, that could be me, because underneath, that's what I am. I'm just a bit of a fake. But, you know, we feel it's part of our thing. I mean, it is partly about jobs. It is partly, of course, about, you know, silver-haired people getting divorced and looking for your third husband. Always looking, but I'm very happily married. It is also about carrying on. I mean, that's the other thing. We have this terrible thing in this country. You get to 60, you're over. And that's the other thing. We should make women realize also that even if you do stay at home and look after your children, for many reasons many women do, there is a life after. Do an open university course when you're at home. We should encourage that. And I don't see us actually doing it. It's there. I'm not saying the government haven't put it in place. But nobody actually says there's a life after kids.
Can we expect feminism to trickle down, do you think, Sue, or not?
Well, I hope so. I mean, the government has done something, which is to increase the state pension age for women to 67, so you can't go to 60 now. I personally do a lot with the people, the women in the most junior grades, because, I would say you can start your career at any time. It's perfectly all right to start when you're 40 or 50 or even 60. And I also, the kind of message I would say is to value those skills that you have that are not particularly to do with education and being clever. You know, when I was a junior civil servant, I thought all those people at the top were incredibly clever. But actually, you know, what I say to you, the junior women now, is if you can get Christmas dinner on the table with six different vegetables, everything hot at 2 o'clock, likelihood is you'll be good at project management. What does the civil service need now? Lots of project management. If you can sort out playground squabbles between children, likelihood is you can deal with warring ministers and special advisers. You know, I spend a great deal of my time basically using emotional intelligence now, and that's needed increasingly in the workplace. So I think the more we can demystify jobs for the more junior grades and make them accessible to them as well and encourage them to have a go. And as Carol says, to feel, you know, I mean, if four people apply for a job, only one gets it. The average experience is failure. You know, as soon as you start to see it that way and think, oh, that's just a practice, you know, perhaps I'll get it next time. So I think it is incumbent on all of us, actually, to reach out to the women in the crappier jobs.
I think it's how do we reach out? How do we do it without looking as if that's exactly,
what... Well, it can be very patronising, it can frankly, be, it and maybe it's the voice that doesn't need to come from here.
Yes, I mean, how do we do it and who should do it? Seems to me to be a very, very relevant question. Who would they want to be the person reaching out? I mean, some of you will have read, I thought it was, it's quite an old book now, but I'm sure Alison read it, Polly Toynbee's book. I've forgotten now what she called it.
It was quite extraordinary the way people simply didn't see her.
Yes, Polly Toynbee took a year off from journalism, I think it's about 10 years ago, and she took a series of very poorly paid jobs, often less than the minimum wage, and as Alison said, she just realised she just wasn't there. And she had some wonderful quotes in the book about the woman at the cash till in Sainsbury's, and mother brings her rather a naughty child with her, and she's really rather fed up with the youngster, and says to him as they get to the till, if you behave like this, you'll be like this woman when you grow up. That's the sort of job you will have. And she said daily there were people who made those sorts of comments. So, I mean, how do you get to that sort of person and make that job more worthwhile? And when I started the job as National Director for Health and Work for the government, I asked them to organise me trips with people I thought had really boring jobs.
and I went with my underground train driver, Baker Street Tube Station, 5 a.m. in the morning, up and down the Bakerloo line. And I got very bored. He didn't seem to get bored. I said, you know, could we go on the Jubilee line? And I said, you know, I normally get up early, but I did have to get up exceptionally early this morning to join you. And I said, so, you know, could you have a different shift? And, you know, if you had a good employer, you'd have 3 weeks below the ground and 1 week above. You know, one of the officers, he dropped me off and was exceedingly pleased to drop me off. And said, look, this is my train. I control it. And really, I think one of the most important things you could give to some of these women is some sense of control. Yes. We all absolutely respond so much better in life if we feel the things we do every day are within, somewhere within our control. This man actually had a very, very good job from his point of view. He didn't find it boring. He was in control. He said, I've got good mates. We share with each other. And I'm reasonably well paid. Go away. I went away. So
got on the Jubilee line, hopefully. Yes. Well, I think that's a fascinating point to leap off and perhaps ask for some questions, because I'm very keen that people get a chance. And also, Alison will join us as well. I'm sure we can. Oh. No, I'm fine. I'm used to falling off the edge. Quite well used to it. We're going to hand the microphones round, but hands ready to go up and we'll speed a microphone to you. There's a lady right at the back. We'll start with her, if I may, with the blonde hair. Lots of lovely blonde hair at the back, of course. Fresh from the hairdressers, perhaps.
Oh, okay. Thank you very much for the presentation. So I'm really interested in this schism that Alison alluded to between the top 15% and the bottom, if you like to call it that, 85%, because we've seen an increase in the number of children who enter higher education in the last few years. We've seen a massive increase in the number of courses, the sorts of levels of courses that people can take. You know, we've seen academies opening, and so the expectation, I think, of students and children is increasingly that they will go to uni. So, you know, why is there this discontinuity? I'm very surprised by that. I would expect to see much more of a continuous variation, if you like, in the attainment. Is it to do with changes in the pattern of employment? And I think you alluded briefly to that in the sense that we've lost a lot of the skilled manufacturing jobs or other sorts of jobs. Some people say that that should be compensated for by an increase in IT, for example. So is that not the case? What really underlies this very discrete difference between the top and the bottom?
I think it is basically the change in the labour market. And I don't want to overdo this, because clearly there are a lot of people who are below the top 15%, where you've got either one or two perfectly decent incomes. And you know, I don't want to imply that it's a world in which you're either a lawyer or a cleaner, because that's clearly not the case. There is this very distinct sort of pattern of life, including a number of other things like, you know, incredibly intense parenting, which it does definitely seem to belong to the top 15%. And the reality is that, again, you're totally right. More and more people are indeed going to university. America, it's been true for longer, huge increases in the number of people with some college or who've graduated with a first degree. And people doing jobs which are jobs which nobody in the past would have expected to do if they had a degree, and which actually increasingly people now feel they have to get a degree even to be able to do those. So I think the real problem, and this is why it's so difficult, is that what is actually happening now, and I think it's too early to say, but what seems to be happening is a really profound change in the labour market, which we none of us have any idea what, if anything, we can do about. And if the pessimists among us are right, and the sort of the flatlining of the Western economy since 2008 continues, then that's actually also going to continue. And what is, of course, actually the case when you look at the numbers is that there's the top group that really has done very well, particularly when you sort of look at it over a lifetime. The bottom group, which has done very badly, and a middle group, which is very much more sort of, it's tenuous and things can send you tumbling down. But coming back to this, I do think there's a problem. I mean, it doesn't mean that people are suddenly going to rise in the streets, because most people are sort of quite realistic and sort of fatalistic about things. But the reality is that we are, by the standards of any previous generation, in labour market terms, wildly overeducating. You know, I've never met anybody who felt they had too much education in terms of character and sort of their view of life. But insofar as the number of jobs at the top is concerned, the huge growth that there was in the period after the war has just levelled off.
I might just squeeze another question and then maybe we can pick it back on just so we can get plenty
of. I won't answer the next one.
Thank you. There's somebody else, a lady here on the left hand side, and then I'll come back down to the front.
Both, yes. Hello, I'm not sure which one's which. My name's Claire McGregor and I'm one of the Newnham Associates. And I'm interested in the social class element. And because I don't normally look like this, and I regularly get taken for a prisoner. Or mistaken for a prisoner, because my world is Style Women's Prison, another red brick institution, but slightly different to Newnham's beautiful buildings. And what we've actually done there, you talked about parents and their babies. They have a mother and baby unit in Style Prison with space for 10 babies and 9 women in case one of them has twins. And there are regularly women there who were born there. So it's that very different cycle of what we're up against. And so what we've actually done is we've started coaching women as equals, one-to-one, the way I'd coach any of you. You know, who are you, what do you want to change, and how can you make it happen? And it is all about, absolutely, that sense of aspiration and control. My very first client said, you've made me realise I can change things just by thinking about them. And what I love is that that's how every single one of us changes things.
Absolutely fascinating perspective on it. Eve, Sue, do you want to pick up on that?
I've gone into prisons as well. It's fascinating, but that is the feeling. There go the notes. That is the feeling that it's very important to give to women. And there are still so many women who are married to, daughters of, mothers of men who think they know better simply because of their gender. And that's the feeling. I mean, you know, you say who should talk? Perhaps the people like Jack Munro or Kate de Moran to say, this is what I did. These are the things that I read. Well, she did some of this in her book. This will make you feel that you can have a bit of control, even if it's sitting there reading the book and not listening to the whine of the child, the television, the husband. How we get that over is really, really hard. And I don't know, maybe it's a education thing, maybe it's a media thing that we should do.
I think it's interesting, so if Sandi was mentioning this morning when we were talking about education, that it absolutely has to perhaps start right in the junior years, where we're talking to girls about even things that they might consider as a path through or an aspiration, and that's, I suppose, that's what you deal with on a daily basis, both of you from a career progression point of view, and both of you from a point of offering women ideas that may not ever have been put before them.
Yes, we just have things called career seminars in Newnham on a regular basis now. And my least successful career seminar, quite frankly, was one on accounting and the insurance industry. And very, very few girls turned up to this. And I sort of asked afterwards, well, you know, why not? They said, well, we're definitely not going into that career, you know. And I said, but, you know, the two women who came, one had read a degree in law and the other had an art history degree. And it's this idea that that you really must explore. You really don't know what the opportunities might be, and it may not be that obvious to start with, but they'd already cut down a whole host of possibilities.
I mean, they may have cut that down for perhaps some might say quite obvious reasons. I'm interested in that idea of class trumping gender as well. And I suspect, you know, for aspiring into working in the civil service,
you know. Well, a lot of, I mean, some of the work we're doing, I also have the Government Equalities Office responsibility for that, with Nikki Morgan as the Secretary of State for Women Equalities. And there is quite a bit of work going on about gender stereotyping starting very, very young, you know, the whole pink and blue thing and the princesses and all of that, and trying to sort of show that if you can have more books about women in work rather than teddy bears when children are very little, that's helpful. But also we're doing some work with parents and actually trying to get parents of girls, you know, young teenagers, to start thinking about good careers that they can go into. You know, we've been doing a lot of work with state schools from that point of view, so we'll just see. Well,
okay, next question. One in the middle here, Sophie Gardner, who she and I were at Newnham together, so that's how I know her name so readily.
This is really odd. My name is Sophie Gardner. I wanted to mention something. I used to volunteer in for the Brownies when I was in the military, because pilots can be a bit irritating and you need a break from them, and 7-year-old girls are quite good fun. And I just wanted to say, you know, that when we did the Royal Wedding Badge, I was based at the same base as William, so they were very keen to do it. So I did it, and we had a tea towel which had the hereditary sort of from William the Conqueror downwards, and I sort of asked the girls if they had any observations. The hand shot up, and the first thing they said was, "There aren't very many women on it, are there?" And I thought, well, my job is done, that's good. But it's going back to this whole class element, because I do think this is the most important bit, and my concern particularly is for those people who really have very few opportunities. And I think this is being perpetuated more and more. And particularly because, and I just want to come back to this employment rights issue. I mean, my best friend is was a hairdresser. She's now doing childcare, mobile, generally hairdresser. And she, every time she's had children, she's had three, she's lost all her clients because she's not, you know, somewhere, you know, where she can sort of hang on to them. And it became so difficult for her that she moved into a lower paid job in childcare in order to be able to hang on to her job. And I think that with the 0-hour contracts, with the kind of low wages, with the lack of care for people, you know, the maternity is actually quite difficult and expensive, the children of these people, I think the gap's getting bigger. And I just would be interested to know what you think. They're not necessarily, I mean, these are not people who would send their children to career seminars or think about going to Newnham, but their rights are becoming eroded more and more. And I just think, do we think inequality is going to increase for women versus men at the very lowest end?
Alison, perhaps.
Yeah, the answer is I honestly don't know, because obviously in this setting we're concentrating on women, but there's also a group of men who are doing very, very badly. And to be honest, I think that the best thing to be in our societies is probably still an alpha man, and the worst thing to be in our societies is, to put it bluntly, a gamma man. So I think they still have the best and also the worst, but also another worst. So I think these gaps are certainly not improving, and one of the things that does worry me, because I think it's inevitable, is that that people like us, who are the people who are going to be in the media, who are going to be making policy, we're like everybody else. We see the world that is around us, and there's a huge part of that world that we don't see. And compared to times when people lived in smaller towns, we actually live in more class-specific environments than our grandparents and great-grandparents did. And so you respond to what you see. So I do think there are real issues. Let me just give you an example of something that really bothered me recently. And again, it's about women, but I was doing some work in Brent, which is an outer London borough, which has huge social problems. I mean, they will tell you, without pride, that they are the beds and sheds capital of England. And that's how bad the housing is. And one of the things that it made me tremendously aware of, for example, is that many of the best-meaning government initiatives, for example, like childcare, actually didn't connect with these women's lives at all. They were constantly moving between one set of private rented accommodation and another set. They often had not actually disrupted family lives. They often had quite stable family lives, but both partners were in and out of short-term work. Some of them had children who had real medical and learning problems, and an awful lot of the policies that we make fit the circumstances of people who are in stable 9-to-5. And childcare is one of my big bugbears on this, actually, because childcare basically, the childcare subsidies work if you're doing a steady middle to upper middle class job. So I do think there is an issue, and I do think that I don't have any real solutions, but it really bothers me that a lot of the time what we see are our own worlds, our own problems. So this might be something where I'm going to disagree with Sandi. I mean, I really don't want to read another article about how the most important thing in the world is to get another female non-exec on another company board. This is really a long way down my list of priorities. And I just think that, again, looking back at previous generations, I sort of worry a bit, and probably this doesn't apply to anybody in this room, and you're all amazing, but as a society, most of our privileged people don't do much for anybody else. Our volunteering data, when you actually look at them, are rubbish. We don't have much of a social conscience. And somewhere else where I go quite often, for example, is Toynbee Hall. I don't want to spend hours, but if you don't know what Toynbee Hall is, you know, Google it. And somehow we don't have that tradition anymore, and it really worries me.
Thank you very much.
True, I think that's true.
Well, there was a lot of nodding there. Yeah. I think it was a moment where we were in absolute agreement in terms of commitments and responsibilities. I also have a responsibility to keep an eye on the clock in this job. I've been quite well trained in this in the last couple of months. So I'd just love to say thank you very much indeed to Professor Wolf for a really thought-provoking speech. It was absolutely fascinating, and I don't doubt that everyone in this room will take something away from it. To Eve Pollard, I know, who's so busy and gave us her time, Woman of the Year, and to Newnham today. To Sue, delightful to meet Sue and hear her expertise, and of course to Dame Carol. And I know there'll be time to talk between us all. I'm sorry if we didn't get all the questions in, but inevitably these are extraordinarily busy women, and clock watching is part of what we do. So thank you very much indeed, and I'll just, I know, I just also wanted to hand over to Jane Luker, who's Chair of Women of the Year.
I just wanted to reiterate my thanks on behalf of Women of the Year to Professor Alison Wolf for such a thought-provoking speech. It's given us much to think about, and I'd like to think that we are on the verge of a female revolution. But I'd also like to thank the panel as well for taking that debate on. So obviously Eve, Sue, and of course to Dame Carol, not only for your contribution here today, but also for welcoming Women of the Year to Newnham, which is, you know, a huge privilege and honour for us. It's our first event outside of London. As part of our 60th anniversary, we felt it was very important to celebrate what Women of the Year has been all about. And I'd like to thank, big thanks to Julie, not only for chairing today so well, but actually for the suggestion of coming to Newnham, because when we were thinking last year about what we should do to celebrate our anniversary, we have a lunch and a lecture for those of you who don't know. We've never done any other events, and Julie came up with this great idea that as a former Newnhamite, wouldn't it be nice to do something and looking about women in leadership? So obviously we met Dame Carol Black, and you embraced that very warmly. And so I'd like to thank you, and indeed your team, and indeed Penny, for helping us so well, and also to Terry on our Women of the Year side, to bringing all the Women of the Year alumni here today. So again, thank you very much. It's been a fantastic event, and we hope it's the beginning of a new and long relationship. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, ladies. That was great.
It was interesting.
It was really interesting.